Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Trump Strategies for Real Estate, Billionaire Lessons for the Small Investor, by George H. Ross, with Andrew James McLean, narrated by Alan Nebelthau. This book is copyrighted 2005 by George H. Ross. This recording is copyrighted 2006 by Recorded Books. For 25 years, George Ross has advised Donald Trump on many of his biggest and most profitable real estate deals. If anyone understands the investment strategies and negotiation tactics that have made Trump the most famous real estate baron in the world, it's Ross. In this book, you'll hear laid out the extraordinary investment principles that have made Donald Trump one of the richest men in the world. And now, Trump Strategies for Real Estate.
Foreword by Donald Trump. To George, there is no one like you. Only you and I know how important a role you played in my success. Thanks for everything. Best wishes, Donald Trump. Preface. I've spent 50 years as a lawyer, business advisor, and deal negotiator for real estate tycoons at the top of the world's toughest real estate market, New York City. I've represented or negotiated with great real estate minds like Harry Helmsley, Sam Lefrak, Bill Zeckendorf, and Donald Trump. It's been my good fortune to spend many of the best years of my career as Donald's right-hand man. These days, most people know me best from the TV show The Apprentice, where Carolyn Kepcher and I helped Donald make tough decisions about whom to fire and whom to keep. The show has been fun, but most of my work for Donald over the past 25 years has been in the world of real estate. I have been an advisor, negotiator, and lawyer on many of his biggest and most successful real estate investments, including the acquisition and renovation of the GM building, Trump Tower on Fifth Avenue, the Grand Hyatt Hotel, and my personal favorite, 40 Wall Street. Throughout my career, I've had the opportunity to acquire a great deal of knowledge and experience in real estate investing, which I hope to pass on to you in this book. For example, during a 10-year period from 1956 to 1966, when Saul Goldman and Alex DiLorenzo Jr. became two of the biggest property owners in New York, I personally bought 702 individual properties on their behalf. I have been intimately involved in many of New York City's most spectacular projects, such as the Chrysler Building and the St. Regis Hotel, which I helped one of my clients buy. I've also had the opportunity to watch Donald Trump in action, as he made some of the greatest real estate investments in history. This book explains the strategies Donald Trump used to make his real estate fortune, and how small investors can apply them to investments of any size, right down to a one-family rental property. I describe how Trump implements some of his signature strategies, such as creating luxury, perceived value, exclusivity, and attention to detail, which all come together to maximize the value of his investments. This is why his properties earn far more money square foot for square foot than his competitors. A number of the chapters focus on a particular real estate investment that I was directly involved in negotiating or advising Trump on. Using this example, I draw out the lessons and explain how the same strategies that Trump used to make huge profits on his deals can work for you, the small investor. Although Trump does things on a grand scale and his target market is usually an elite, luxury customer, Trump's basic real estate strategies will be of interest to 1. Anyone who is interested in owning or developing real estate. 2. Anyone unsure of how to negotiate a real estate transaction. 3. Anyone who is in real estate on a small scale but would like to do more. And 4. Anyone interested in learning how Donald Trump does his magic. This is the first book on Trump's strategies for the real estate investor. Although it has a lot of nuts and bolts guidance and investing principles, the book alone will not make you a great investor. As I tell the students who take my negotiation course at New York University, there's no way in 15 hours that I can make you an excellent negotiator. It is impossible. All I want to do is open your mind to the possibilities and the power of negotiating and some basic techniques. Then, when you run into a specific situation, you can go back to your notes and say, "How did George handle this?" Or, "What does he suggest?" You already have some ideas about real estate, but I've learned many things in my 25 years working with Trump and 50 years in the real estate business that I'd like to pass along to you. If I am successful, this book will help you negotiate far better deals, arrange better financing, make better investments, and earn significantly more money in real estate. I recall the day I first met Donald Trump in 1974. He entered my office at the law firm of Dreyer & Traub, beaming with enthusiasm about a project he wanted to do with the old Commodore Hotel on 42nd Street in New York City. He was just 27 years old at the time, and I was a senior partner known for completing complex deals. But I agreed to see him out of courtesy because I represented his father, Fred Trump. Fred had spoken enthusiastically about Donald's promise as a future star in the real estate world. Donald laid out his incredibly complex plan for buying the huge, dumpy, rundown hotel next to Grand Central Station and turning it into a first-class, state-of-the-art business hotel. I told him it was a brilliant idea, but there was no way it would ever work, given the number of powerful people and governmental agencies he would have to convince to grant him major concessions. Nevertheless, if he was willing to pay the legal fees, I was willing to help him take a shot at it. We spent the next 2 years negotiating with railroad executives, city and state officials, lenders, and Hyatt executives, making the deal happen. During those tumultuous 2 years, Donald and I developed a great working relationship and mutual respect. When he miraculously pulled off the deal, I was so sure he would be a huge success in real estate that I became his closest advisor and lawyer. How my career started. When I was young, growing up in Brooklyn, New York, I planned to go to MIT to be an engineer, but my father died suddenly when I was 16, and that plan died with him. At 17, I enlisted in the U.S. Army because they offered to send me to college. When I went on active duty, I was trained as a cryptanalyst, a code breaker, and spent most of my short Army career in Washington, D.C. The analytical skills, patience, and tenacity I learned as a code breaker helped me when I was faced with seemingly unresolvable real estate problems. With the help of the GI Bill, I obtained my BA degree at Brooklyn College and entered Brooklyn Law School. Working 3 jobs concurrently and with the support of my working wife, I graduated and was admitted to the New York Bar in 1953. While looking for a job, I saw an ad in the Law Journal for a law clerk. As luck would have it, the person who answered the phone was Bill, a friend from law school. He was working for Dreyer & Traub, a well-known real estate law firm. Bill said, "You don't want this job. You'll be nothing but a messenger, and it only pays $25 a week." But I took it anyway. That was the inauspicious beginning of my legal career. Although Dreyer & Traub was a law firm dealing primarily with real estate matters, they handled litigation as a courtesy for their clients, and Bill and I worked in the litigation department. Several months later, there was an opening upstairs in the real estate acquisition and leasing practice, the place where real money was made. It was an excellent opportunity for advancement, and Bill was slotted for the job. I was to take his spot in litigation. But before he could start, he was drafted into the Army and recommended me for the real estate position. Once upstairs, I had the good fortune to apprentice to Murray Felton, a very tough taskmaster. He was so demanding that if I put a comma in the wrong place, I would hear about it for days. But Felton was a superb technician and highly regarded in the world of real estate attorneys. I knew that working with him was a great opportunity to learn the intricacies of real estate law from a perfectionist, so I soaked up every bit of helpful information I could from him. I became adept at drafting leases, real estate documents, and participating in all types of transactions. My prior litigation experience added to the perception that I was a competent, though young, real estate attorney. Learning the real estate business. In 1955, one of my clients asked me to draft a commercial lease for him, even though he was to be the tenant. Usually, the landlord's attorney drafts the lease. But in this case, the landlord told my client to have his lawyer prepare the lease. So I drew up the lease and inserted a provision stating that the tenant didn't have to pay any rent before the landlord made a certain elevator operational. My client moved in, and as it turned out, the elevator inspector for New York City refused to accept the elevator repairs the landlord made, insisting that only a brand new elevator would get his approval. The elevator stayed out of operation for a very long time, but throughout that period, my client was still able to carry out his normal business operations. The owners, Saul Goldman and Alex DiLorenzo Jr., had a tenant in possession, utilizing the premises for its normal business operations, but because of that clause in the lease, the tenant was not paying them any rent. Although the landlords were very unhappy, they were helpless. In the mid-1950s, Goldman and DiLorenzo, who were both multimillionaires, had decided to invest in real estate on a huge scale. I had decided to leave Dreyer and Traub because I had been told that there was no possibility for me to become a partner in the firm. I happened to mention my impending departure to Saul Goldman. He called me a few days later and said, "George, Alex and I would like you to be our counsel." I said, "Why me?" He said, "Well, we already paid $90,000 in the form of lost rent just for the privilege of knowing you. We'll make it worth your while if you say yes." I accepted their offer. Every problem has a price tag. Very quickly, I learned something that every real estate investor should understand. There is a huge difference between the legal aspects of real estate and the business of investing in real estate. I had to restructure my whole way of thinking. Whenever I discovered a legal problem with a real estate deal, Goldman would say, "Is it serious enough to blow the deal?" If I said no, then he would say, "How much can I get off the price for the problem?" Most lawyers simply advise their clients not to do a deal if they find legal problems. Lawyers cannot or will not make business recommendations for their clients. Goldman forced me to think like a businessman, not just a lawyer, and realize that almost every problem has a price tag. He forced me to look at legal problems strictly as a way of improving the deal. He'd say, "What can I get if I overlook this problem?" To find that answer, I had to dig into the problem. For example, Goldman and DiLorenzo contracted to buy Harborside Terminal in Jersey City, New Jersey, from the railroad that owned it. The property consisted of a huge cold storage warehouse of almost 2 million square feet, abutting the Hudson River, right across the river from downtown Manhattan. The purchase price seemed reasonable, even though it was to be an all-cash deal. However, the title report contained an exception for possible claims of the state of New Jersey to a strip of land that the warehouse straddled. It became clear to me why the railroad was having difficulty finding a buyer. No lawyer would let a client buy the property with such a defect, and certainly no bank would place a mortgage on it. The problem related to land underwater that was filled in sometime in the 1800s. A law was passed stipulating that if the land underwater was filled in by the adjoining landowner before 1849, the landowner had good title to it. If it was filled in after 1849, the state of New Jersey owned it. I couldn't prove when it was filled in and who filled it, nor could the state of New Jersey. I told Saul we should get a price reduction and convince the railroad to take back a long-term purchase money mortgage at a low interest rate, since no lender would make any loan because of the title defect. The railroad agreed to reduce the purchase price by $400,000 and to take a sizable mortgage, so we closed the deal. Several years went by, but the title impediment still stuck in my craw. I was certain that the state of New Jersey must have encountered the same problem in the past, since much of the land abutting on the Hudson River was filled in land. I contacted the state and learned that they were aware of the problem, and rather than sit with a dubious claim, they had passed a statute giving the state the right to give up its claim in exchange for the value of their interest in the disputed land. Following the procedure outlined in the statute, we paid a minimal amount and received a quitclaim deed to the land in dispute from the state of New Jersey. As a result, the property appreciated in value so much that a bank made a first mortgage loan in an amount exceeding the total purchase price paid by Goldman and DiLorenzo. From 1956 to 1966, Goldman and DiLorenzo were New York real estate. When I arrived at Goldman and DiLorenzo in 1956, they owned 18 properties. When I left in 1966, they owned 720. I negotiated and handled almost all of these purchases by myself with very little supervision from them. We were buying Manhattan ground leases by the dozen, warehouses in New York Harbor, and multi-million dollar office buildings. We were dealing in big numbers, and much of it was done with cash. Many times I walked into a closing on property with a certified check for millions of dollars in my wallet. I was also given a standing million-dollar deposit by Goldman and DiLorenzo with which to negotiate. Goldman and DiLorenzo would tell me what type of deal they wanted, and my job was to make it happen. They were not anxious buyers, so if I didn't think the deal met their terms, I would kill it and go on to the next one. That's what enabled them to acquire so much real estate so quickly. During that 10-year period, I bought the Chrysler Building, the St. Regis Hotel, the land under the Plaza Hotel, Harborside Terminal in Jersey City, and numerous ground leases on their behalf. A ground lease is a long-term lease for land on which a building sits and gives the tenant all the rights and obligations of operation and ownership, except title to the land. Goldman and DiLorenzo's appetite for real estate was voracious. They had excellent financing connections, which enabled me to close transactions quickly. As their loan lawyer and business representative, I had almost unlimited authority to negotiate, but not to increase the purchase price. I negotiated with Harry Helmsley, Bill Zeckendorf, and Morris Karp, to name a few. These were all the big names in New York real estate at that particular time. Pretty heady stuff for a 30-year-old lawyer. For the first few years I worked for Goldman and DiLorenzo, I was in over my head. At Dreyer and Traub, I was handling closings on single-family homes in New Jersey. I had never done a contract and closing on any office building of any size. Now I was thrust into an arena involving the purchase and operation of huge office buildings. I really had no prior training or experience. Yet everyone thought, because I was so young and represented these millionaires in huge transactions, I must be brilliant, so they treated me as an equal. I knew how green I was, but I wasn't going to dispute their assessment of me. I learned as fast as I could from everyone I came in contact with, including all the people on the other side, the lawyers and other professionals, and the real estate moguls themselves. I concentrated on what they did, how they did it, how they acted and reacted in certain situations, and anything else that would fill the void of my ineptitude. I was like a sponge, absorbing every bit of information I could. Before long, my crash course in real estate paid off, and I began to give my clients well-reasoned opinions as to which deals were good and which were not, and what price to pay. This gave me a unique combination of talents. Most lawyers don't know the business of real estate, and therefore they are not equipped to make business decisions. They are ready to render advice on any legal issue, but leave the business decisions to their client. Radio days. Any good lawyer will make lots of money while practicing law. But since lawyering is a service business, the income stops when you step down. I recognized the need to invest in some enterprise that would be of value in my later years. In 1966, my brother-in-law, Martin Beck, was leaving the Katz Agency, a big name in the business of selling radio time. He suggested that we look for investment opportunities together. He thought radio broadcasting on Long Island would be profitable. I told him, "I don't know anything about the radio business." He said, "I know all about radio, but I don't know how to raise the capital necessary for a venture." I told him, "You find and run the stations, and I'll find the money to make it happen." In 1966, we formed Beck Ross Communications Corporation and bought our first radio station in Long Island, WGLI, for approximately $450,000. Marty knew how to make money in radio broadcasting. Using the profits from WGLI and by expanding our financial contacts, we embarked on a plan of expansion. FM broadcasting was in its infancy, but the superiority of the sound made it an attractive prospect. we purchased several other stations, both AM and FM, increased their market share, and then sold them at huge profits. In 1986, Marty and I bought out all of our investors for 25 times their original investment. In 1987, we were faced with a decision that many investors confront at some time: to expand the business or sell out to someone who would. We chose to take a substantial profit and leave the expansion to the buyer. But the radio business was only a sideline to my law career. In 1966, after 10 years with Goldman and DiLorenzo, my reputation had grown to the point where I could have received a partnership with any quality law firm with a real estate department. I opted to return as a partner to my old firm, Dreyer & Traub, where I was being accepted as a senior partner. I realized that since only two young attorneys had become new partners in the past 10 years, and the old partners were reaching retirement, it would be my firm within a few years. That's exactly what happened. By the early 1970s, I became one of four senior partners running one of the best real estate law firms in New York, with as many as 120 lawyers. I led that firm for more than 20 years. Eventually, I got tired of dealing with partnership politics, gave up the active practice of law, got a severance package, and joined the Edward S. Gordon Company, where my role for the next 10 years was to supply real estate expertise to major clients like United Technologies, IBM, The New York Times, and AT&T. How I came to work for Donald Trump. Although I left the active practice of law in 1987, I remained friendly with Donald Trump, and though I had worked with him on many of his most successful projects, I was no longer his lawyer. When the New York City real estate market tanked in 1990, Trump hit the rocks. It was not due to a lack of business acumen. Rather, his phenomenal success had created an air of invincibility. Because he had been so incredibly successful, he began to think that any business he touched would turn to gold. The banks would throw money at him. If he asked to borrow $60 million for a building, they gave him $80 million. When the bottom fell out of the New York City real estate market, he was vastly overextended and was over $990 million in debt. He owed so much money that the lenders knew if they forced him into bankruptcy, it would have a disastrous effect on the real estate market. They had many bad loans that they didn't want to write off, so they came up with a plan that would enable him to work his way back by agreeing to accept a substantial reduction if the loans were repaid by a certain future date. Even though I was no longer a member of a law firm, I wanted to help. I told Donald that if he ever needed legal advice or counsel while he was in trouble, I would be happy to do it for him without charge. He was impressed and asked me why I would do that. I said, "Donald, I think a lawyer has a responsibility to represent a client when he's down, not only when he's on top. I'm here if you need me." Trump never accepted my offer, because it's not his style to get something for nothing, but I am sure he appreciated the gesture. My philosophy has since paid off in spades. With Donald Trump, loyalty goes a long way. In the mid-1990s, Donald had two deals going: the new Nike building adjoining Trump Tower, and 40 Wall Street. Both were plagued with problems because of the lawyers involved, and very little was getting accomplished. Donald knows when to use delay tactics, but he also hates deals that drag on and on. So he hired me to eliminate the roadblocks and get those deals done. While I was working on them, I told Donald that I was bored with my life at Gordon and was planning to retire. He asked me to join the Trump Organization on a full-time basis. He said, "I've got a lot of great things going, and you'll have fun." We quickly agreed on terms. I only work 4 days a week. And 10 years later, I'm still an important part of the Trump team. My title is Senior Executive Vice President and Senior Counsel for the Trump Organization, and my primary function is to give Donald Trump business and legal advice. I offer my opinion as to the feasibility of his proposed projects, which he is free to accept or reject. He likes to bounce things off me before reaching his own decision. He knows that I will call it like I see it and give him an unbiased opinion. I'm currently responsible for developing many foreign investments for Donald and supervising the leasing and operation of 40 Wall Street and Trump Tower. Additionally, I teach a course at New York University on negotiation. Negotiation is a subject that I have made a study of throughout my career, because it is such a critical part of real estate success. I could easily fill a book on this subject. For a discussion of some of the principles and techniques used by Trump that I think are most valuable, see chapters 3 and 4. Trump has been a great man to work for. In 10 years, he has never once asked me where I was going or what I'm doing. That's the kind of trust we have. When he gave me responsibility for 40 Wall Street, I took the building from where it was, a 1 million square foot nearly vacant structure he purchased for $1 million, to where it is now, a thriving office building worth in excess of $350 million. After 40 Wall Street had been rented and become extremely profitable for Trump, I said to him, "I think I'm entitled to a bonus for 40 Wall Street." Trump's reply was, "How much do you think you're entitled to?" I gave him a figure. He said, "You've got it." It's this kind of recognition that makes it a pleasure to work for him. Fred Trump once said to Donald, when he needed a lawyer, "You would be hard-pressed to find a wiser, more loyal, or a better advisor and lawyer than George Ross." I'm delighted Donald took that advice and gave me the opportunity to work with a true real estate genius. Now I hope to pass on to you some of the powerful investing strategies I've learned from some of the greatest real estate minds in the business. Acknowledgements. My gratitude to Donald J. Trump for becoming such an important part of my life as a friend and for giving me the unique opportunity throughout my career to help turn his visions of spectacular projects into realities. Chapter 1. Sell yourself like Trump. 5 personal qualities you need to succeed in real estate. Key points. Number 1. Use your enthusiasm for the project to inspire others. 2. Build relationships with everyone involved in a deal. 3. Showmanship is a real estate strategy. 4. Be better prepared than anyone else. 5. Be tenacious. Donald Trump became a billionaire in real estate by making a series of incredibly creative and successful investments in New York City properties. He is now the largest real estate developer in New York and is widely acknowledged to be one of the most brilliant real estate investing minds anywhere. For example, in the early 1980s, with the building of Trump Tower on Fifth Avenue, he single-handedly created the market for high-end luxury residences in New York City. He continued with a string of successes, and in 2003, 9 of the 10 highest-selling apartments were in Trump buildings, apartments that sold for millions of dollars each. What can a small real estate investor learn from a billionaire developer like Trump? After advising Trump on many of his biggest investments over 25 years, I'm convinced that small investors can successfully use many of the same principles that earn him millions. It's not the scale of your real estate investment project that counts. Whether you are investing in a single-family rental, a 4-unit rental, or a multi-million-dollar office building makes no difference to the financial success of your particular project. What's important are the real estate investing strategies used to acquire and develop the property, and how you design and market the property to buyers or tenants. Many of the same principles that work for one of Trump's $300 million skyscrapers work just as well for smaller properties. Anyone interested in investing in real estate can benefit from a study of Trump's real estate investor strategies. For example, you can't make big real estate investments or really profitable small investments without projecting certain personal qualities that inspire confidence in others and make them want to help you or see things your way. The key personal qualities you need are enthusiasm, relationship building skills, showmanship, preparation, and tenacity. Donald Trump has these qualities in spades, as he demonstrated on his first big real estate deal, the transformation of the dilapidated Commodore Hotel on 42nd Street in New York City into the magnificent Grand Hyatt. Remarkably, Trump used very little of his own money in this transaction, yet later sold his half-interest to Hyatt for $85 million. This chapter will describe how these 5 key personal qualities helped Trump make the Commodore Hyatt deal work and how small investors can use these same qualities in their own real estate investments to negotiate better deals, sell properties for more money, and dramatically improve real estate profits. Investing case study. Trump's Commodore Hyatt project. This real estate investment was a monster as far as complexity was concerned. It was 1974. New York City was struggling to survive, and Trump decided that this was a great time to buy a huge, dilapidated, nearly empty building on 42nd Street next to Grand Central Station. Like many of the best real estate investors, he looks at problem properties and sees opportunities. Trump's plan was to convert this old building, the Commodore Hotel, into a 1,400-room first-class convention hotel, the largest since the New York Hilton was built 25 years earlier. When 27-year-old Donald Trump explained his grandiose idea to me during our first meeting, I told him that based on existing conditions, he was chasing an impossible dream that would never happen. I thought the idea was brilliant, but it was totally unrealistic, given the economic environment and the huge cast of characters who would have to embrace a set of entirely new concepts for the idea to work. Trump would have to win major financial concessions from 1. Penn Central, a bankrupt railroad that owned the land on which the Commodore Hotel was built. 2. New York City, which was facing bankruptcy. 3. The state of New York, which had no money to contribute to any venture. 4. A lender who was holding many defaulted loans on New York real estate. 5. A major hotel chain that was not pursuing new facilities in New York City since tourism and occupancy rates were extremely low. And 6. Existing tenants occupying the building. The deal involved successful negotiation of several treacherous interconnected transactions. If Trump failed to conclude any one of these transactions, it would sink the entire project. Using the 5 personal qualities outlined in this chapter, he had to 1. Obtain an option to buy the Commodore Hotel from the Penn Central Railroad for $12 million. 2. Convince the representatives of Penn Central Railroad to turn over the $12 million purchase price to New York City, which was owed $15 million in back taxes from the Penn Central. 3. Convince New York City to accept the $12 million to cover $15 million in back taxes and agree to the creation of a long-term lease that would give the city a share of profits in lieu of future real estate taxes. 4. Convince the Urban Development Corporation, a New York state agency, to accept title to the property, then grant a long-term lease on the property to Trump and to use its right of eminent domain to obtain possession from existing tenants. 5. Find a major hotel operator willing to participate in the ownership and operation of the new hotel to give credibility to the creation of profits in which New York City would share. And 6. Find a bank willing to lend $80 million to cover all of the costs involved in purchasing and developing the property. This was as complex as it sounds. Something like this had never been done before. To jump ahead to the end of the story, Trump pulled it off, convincing all these parties to work with him, using his enthusiasm, relation-building skills, showmanship, preparation, and tenacity. In September of 1980, the Grand Hyatt opened, and it was a great success from day one. The renovated Hyatt helped revitalize the whole Grand Central Station neighborhood in New York City, which in turn played a major role in reversing the failing, bankrupt image of the city in the 1970s. By 1987, gross operating profits at the Hyatt exceeded $30 million annually. Years later, after recouping his modest cash investment in the property, Trump sold his half interest to Hyatt for $85 million. Here's how Trump used his critical personal qualities to clinch that monumental real estate deal. You can use the same qualities in your own dealings, regardless of their size or complexity. Use your enthusiasm for the project to inspire others. Enthusiasm is a crucial element of the investment game because your success depends largely on capturing the imagination and securing the cooperation of key players, buyers, sellers, lenders, tenants, contractors, and others. If you're not enthusiastic about your real estate investment idea, There's no way you can get someone else to sign on. Remember that people will initially be skeptical of whatever you say. So be like Trump. Sell hard. If you can maintain your level of commitment and enthusiasm in the face of initial doubts, you've taken the first step toward getting the support you will need to succeed. Trump knows that enthusiasm is contagious. For example, Trump's enthusiasm for the Commodore Hyatt project and the way he envisioned it benefiting the entire city of New York were boundless. He communicated his vision over and over to all of the people who were involved in the various governmental agencies, including the mayor's office and the railroad. He argued that this one project could help turn around the entire blighted Midtown Manhattan area. They all agreed that it was important to do something about this eyesore, the Commodore, because of its critical location next to Grand Central Station. Trump's enthusiasm convinced them that he was the only person capable of putting all the pieces together. For example, he told the city, "Forget real estate taxes and concentrate on the money you'll earn from room taxes, income taxes paid to the city on the salaries earned by the employees working in the new hotel, and the profits from the hotel operation." Trump offered to make New York City a partner in the profits. "Think about how the new construction will bring desperately needed jobs to New York and reestablish New York City as the capital of the world." Trump's enthusiasm was the catalyst for getting key people, whose support he needed to achieve success, interested in the deal and to getting the city to embrace the idea. He prepared charts and graphics showing the dreary existing conditions of the area and the likelihood of an extended recession in property values leading to further erosion of the city's tax base. He explained, "This is what you've got now, but here's what I can do for you." He would then display a dramatic color rendering of the building as it would appear when renovated and sell this as the linchpin of revitalizing the Grand Central area, which in turn was the cornerstone of the reconstruction of the image of New York City. All he initially sought was the city's acknowledgement that this was a great idea, coupled with a loose commitment to cooperate in bringing it to fruition if they got everything they wanted. He never talked numbers with the key players in this deal until after he got an initial expression of interest and support for his plan. He knew that talking numbers too soon would give people a reason to say no to his plan. It's a valuable lesson for you to remember in any real estate investment of yours. Enthusiasm, and focusing initially on the large outlines of a deal rather than the financial details, can overcome many obstacles. How small real estate investors can use enthusiasm. The Hotel Commodore conversion was a huge project that took over 2 years and 23 drafts of a complicated and intensely negotiated ground lease to finish. But no matter what the size or complexity of your real estate project, at various stages of the transaction, you'll need to convince other people to help you and do what you want them to do. This takes enthusiasm and perseverance. Share with the seller, your lenders, contractors, and others what you envision for the property you want to buy or renovate. Tell a great story about how you found it, what your inspiration was, and the difficulties you have already overcome. Play up what you see as its best or most unique features. Trump knows that people like to be excited. You just have to find creative ways to excite them. If you're not enthusiastic, the people you're trying to convince to lend you money, sell you a property, or invest in your partnership are not going to stick their necks out. But if you can tell a great story about your investment idea, if you are articulate and enthusiastic about the opportunity you are offering others, you are on your way to developing the requisite rapport with buyers, sellers, lenders, or other decision makers. Build relationships with everyone involved in a deal. The success of any real estate investment, or any business deal, for that matter, is not strictly a matter of dollars and cents. A lot of it comes down to personal relationships. Your ability to forge strong cooperative relationships with all parties, whether they are directly or even tangentially involved. Trump does this by taking the time necessary to gain insight into the people he is dealing with, who they are, what they do, how they do business, who are their family members or friends, and, if appropriate, what their hobbies are. If you can establish a rapport and a feeling of mutual trust, it invariably makes for an easier negotiation and a faster, more amicable conclusion to any problems that arise. The principle here is, no one intends to buy a bucket of trust, but they will pay for it if it's delivered. Give people reasons to trust you by building a relationship with them, and you'll be laying the foundation for long-term real estate investing success. The reason you have to build relationships, especially at the beginning of a real estate transaction, is that people are naturally suspicious of others. Until you have built up a level of trust, it is likely that what you say will be somewhat discounted. One way to build a good relationship is to assume that the present transaction you're working on is only the beginning of negotiating many deals with your counterparts. Work hard to create the impression of being a nice person to deal with. Some of Trump's best deals were the result of recommendations from adversaries with whom he had past dealings. Leaving pleasant memories is the best personal advertisement in any real estate transaction. Here's a great example of Trump's relation-building skill in action from the Commodore Hyatt deal. Trump had never met Victor Palmieri, an executive with Penn Central Railroad, which owned the Commodore Hotel, but Trump knew Palmieri would have to play a key role if Trump's idea was to become reality. With full confidence in his project and his salesmanship, Donald Trump called Palmieri, introduced himself, and said, "Give me 15 minutes of your time, and we can reverse the decline of the city of New York."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.